Morning, everyone. So wonderful to be in the Lord's house today. Just lift up the announcements that you see on the screen. We're still taking donations for the Hands of Mercy Food Bank. We had two barrels full to overflowing going out on the floor this past Friday. So that's wonderful. And some of you have been making contributions to the church, and we're forwarding those on to the food bank. So thank you for that. The Bible study, Sunday evening Bible study, will meet tonight at 6:30, and they will begin a series of studies on the book of Isaiah. So everyone is welcome to meet with them in the fellowship hall. Also, the session will meet this Tuesday evening, the 14th, at 6:30 p.m. If you have anything you want the session to deal with or talk about, just let me or one of the elders know about that. Also, just another reminder about the social distance. They call it social distance, but it's really more of a physical distance type of thing. Just a reminder about those. Some folks have called me and expressed concern about the spike in cases. And I know you can make the argument that it's more testing or more this or more that. But let's be good neighbors. Let's love our brothers and sisters in Christ and try to honor their concerns there. Are there any other announcements that we need to make this morning? Catechism question then is, what is the work of the Holy Spirit? The work of the Holy Spirit is to reprove the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment, to regenerate, comfort, and guide those who trust in Christ. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you. Greet one another in the name of Christ. Praise be to the Lord, for he has heard my cry for mercy.
The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart leaps for joy. I will give thanks to him in song.
The Lord is the strength of his people, a fortress of salvation.
Praise be to the Lord.
Let us pray. Merciful Father, we come to you this morning, and we want to adore and magnify and give glory to your precious and holy name through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, may we be ever thankful that you are indeed a fortress of our salvation, that you are indeed our shield and strength. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let's remain standing for our praise chorus. It's number 541, The Joy of the Lord. Hymn, it's number 105, We Will Glorify.
We will glorify.
Let us now affirm our faith together using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Number 563, open my eyes that I may see.
Now's the time when we usually would take up an offering, so we'll just offer a reminder of our offering, if you will. And the plates are at the back of the sanctuary, along with the noisy offering cans. That goes for the Hands of Mercy Food Bank. And as always, you can mail in your donation here to the church, or you can use the donate button on the church's website. We want to take prayer requests and praise reports right now. Some that I've received in the past 24 hours. Remember Mark Lewis. Mark Lewis is a family friend of Jerry and June Wilson, and he is in the hospital with a serious case of COVID-19. So be in prayer for Mark. Also remember Marilyn Whitaker. That's June's niece. She also has COVID-19. You know, I hear people ask, do you know anybody who has it? Well, yeah, we now know somebody who knows somebody, and I know somebody who actually does have it. Jim Buttram, who was the pastor at Oak Ridge Church for several years. Some of you might remember him. His granddaughter has COVID-19. So let's remember all of the people along those lines. Also remember Jerry Roberts. Jerry will be having surgery for something in his hand this coming Tuesday. So let's remember Jerry in our prayers. Are there any other prayer requests or words of praise this morning? Miss Lily.
My friend Melanie.
Melanie?
Yes.
And the last name again? You talk. I still don't know if I have it, but that's okay. Anyway. We'll do that, Lily. All right. Anyone else? Jenny.
Yeah, her daughter Joanna was medical that she has.
Okay. Anyone else? Yes, I'm sorry.
My wife's two brothers, one lives in Maryville, having had bladder stem cell cancer almost 2 years ago. He's doing well, but him and his wife have gotten the virus. Sharon's been exposed to it.
So the brother in Maryville has COVID, and Sharon has been exposed, and the brother that lives with you but he's having a biopsy.
He's had a biopsy. He's waiting for results.
Okay. Okay.
But I have a praise report too, since having not been here for a while. May the 20th, my bride turned 73. May the 21st, by the grace of God, we celebrated 54.
So May the 21st, 54 years of marriage.
May the 20th, she was 73. May the 21st.
So you robbed the cradle at 19 when she was 19?
Yes.
I can't talk. I did the same thing. All right. So that is a praise.
God has definitely answered prayer and poured out the blessing through it all.
Amen. Anyone else? Well, let us pray. Merciful God, we come before you on this blessed day that you've given to us, and we just want to praise you and magnify you for who you are. Lord, you, as the scriptures tell us, are to be exalted above all things, and to you and you alone belongs all glory, honor, and praise. And Father, we gladly give it to you. We gladly come before you and humbly bow down, and as we do so, we confess our sins to you. Father, Our sins are a burden upon us. Our sins bruise us and as we try to carry them with us. But Father, you have told us not to do that. Lord, you have said that when we make a mess of things, we can come to you and fall on our face and seek forgiveness. Lord, and that's what we do this morning. We seek your forgiveness. Father, forgive us. Cleanse us from our sins. Take away our iniquities. And Lord, as we confess and ask for that forgiveness, we do so in the sure confidence that you will indeed wash us and make us whiter than snow according to the promise of your word through the blood of your precious and beloved Son. Lord, we come now and we lift up our prayer requests to you. Lord, you know we know that you hear our prayers and that you answer them. Lord, you have been involved in every area of our lives. And we just pray now, especially for those that we've lifted up this morning. Father, those that are facing the COVID-19 virus, we just ask for healing in their bodies. We pray for those that are caring for them, that they would have the strength to do so. And we pray for family, Father, who are facing this virus in ways that some of us here this morning are not. Lord, we lift up the little cousin who was involved in a car accident, Lily's friend. We just ask for healing there. We lift up all of these other requests, Father, for Joanna Griffin, a medical test, Sharon's brother who has the virus, another brother who is awaiting results of a biopsy. And Lord, we thank you that you are involved there. And Lord, we give you praise for 54 years of marriage between Melvin and Sharon Carney. We thank you for that. And Lord, we just want to be careful to honor you and glorify you here this morning. Lord, help us as your people to be filled with your grace, that we might love all that we meet in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we might share the gospel of your truth and of your word with them. Lord, strengthen us with the power of your Spirit. Give us endurance. Give us patience in the days that lay ahead of us. And Lord, may we live our lives giving thanks to you, because you have made us a part of your glorious kingdom. You have rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of your beloved Son. And Lord, we close this prayer now with the prayer that he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Right now, Jessica Babineau and her daughter Lily are going to come and share with us in song. And I always think it's a blessing when family comes and they share their faith with us. So be in prayer for them.
You look around and staring back at you another way of doubt. Will it pull you under? You wonder, what if I overtake it? What if I never make it? What if no one's there? Will you hear my prayer? If you take that first step into the unknown, he won't let to waste. Don't wait, don't you turn around me. your insecurities, try to alter you. You know you're meant for more. Don't be afraid to move. Your faith is all it takes, and you can walk.
Jessica, thank you, Lily. You know, that song is a wonderful reminder. You know, we say we believe in Christ, but do we believe what he tells us? Do we believe in his word? Let's trust in his word and have faith that he is with us and that he's walking with us in all these things. Scripture reading for this morning comes from 2 Samuel. You'll find up on the screen, I think it's verses 5 through 14. I encourage you once again to have your Bibles open, because the passage for this morning is really chapter 18 all the way through chapter 19 and verse 8. And we're going to try to hit the high points in there, sort of flying 30,000 feet over top of it. But I'm going to be reading verses 5 through 15 in the 18th chapter, then pick back up in verse 32 of that chapter, and then the first few verses of chapter 19. Hear now God's word. And the king ordered Joab and Abishai and Ittai, deal gently for my sake with the young man Absalom. And all the people heard when the king gave orders to all the commanders about Absalom. So the army went out into the field against Israel, and the battle was fought in the forest of Ephraim. And the men of Israel were defeated there by the servants of David. And the loss there was great on that day, 20,000 men. The battle spread over the face of all the country, and the forest devoured more people that day than the sword. And Absalom happened to meet the servants of David. Absalom was riding on his mule, and the mule went under the thick branches of a great terebinth. And his head caught fast in the oak, and he was suspended between heaven and earth while the mule that was under him went on. And a certain man saw it and told Joab, "Behold, I saw Absalom hanging in an oak." Joab said to the man who told him, "What? You saw him? Why then did you not strike him there to the ground? I would have been glad to give you 10 pieces of silver and a belt." But the man said to Joab, "Even if I felt in my hand the weight of 1,000 pieces of silver, I would not reach out my hand against the king's son. For in our hearing the king commanded you and Abishai and Ittai, 'For my sake, protect the young man Absalom.' On the other hand, if I had dealt treacherously against his life, and there is nothing hidden from the king, then you yourself would have stood aloof." Joab said, "I will not waste time like this with you." And he took 3 javelins in his hand and thrust them into the heart of Absalom while he was still alive in the oak. And 10 young men, Joab's armor bearers, surrounded Absalom and struck him and killed him. I think about that a minute. 10 people to carry his armor? That's a lot of armor, isn't it? I mean, you know, he could have at least, I don't know, wore a utility belt or something. Anyway, I've just That's just an aside. Back in verse 32 of chapter 18, and David is talking here. There's been several verses of who's going to deliver the news, and two people deliver the news. Two people are running, and the first messenger has only delivered part of the news, and the second messenger is a Cushite. And the king said to the Cushite, this is verse 32, "Is it well with the young man Absalom?" And the Cushite answered, "May the enemies of my lord the king and all who rise up against you for evil be like that young man." And the king was deeply moved, and he went up to the chamber over the gate, and he wept. And as he went, he said, "O my son Absalom, my son Absalom, would I had died instead of you, O Absalom, my son, my son." And then chapter 19, it was told Joab, "Behold, the king is weeping and mourning for Absalom." So the victory that day was turned into mourning for all of the people. For the people heard that day, "The king is grieving for his son." And the people stole into the city that day, as people steal in who are ashamed when they flee in battle. The king covered his face, and the king cried with a loud voice, "O my son Absalom, O Absalom, my son, my son." Then Joab came into the house to the king and said, "You have today covered with shame the faces of all of your servants who have this day saved your life and the lives of your sons and your daughters and the lives of your wives and of your concubines, because you love those who hate you and hate those who love you. For you have made it clear today that the commanders and servants are nothing to you. For today I know that if Absalom were alive and all of us were dead today, then you would be pleased." Let us pray. Father, just a few moments ago, we sang a prayer to you, Father, to open our eyes and to illumine them, to open our ears and illumine our ears, and to open our hearts, Father. So, Father, may we make that our prayer as we come to your word. Illuminate us through the power of your Spirit. In your name we pray. Amen. You know, if you read this story, there's so much going on in this chapter. I sat there and it was hard to know where to start because there's so many twists and so many turns in this twisted story. If you read it, Absalom is the focus of the story, but Absalom does not say a word. David is the king, but the king's commands are not followed. Joab is the king's loyal servant, but Joab is the one who disobeys the king. The news of the victory, instead of bringing joy, it brings grief and it brings mourning to the people. Troops that are conquering troops, they enter into the city. Instead of proudly and victoriously, they tiptoe in, as it were, as if they had ran away in full retreat during the battle. Everything happens in this chapter, in this story, that shouldn't happen. Good intentions are not matched with right results. David and his men are victorious, but it is a sad victory. And as we come to the 18th chapter of 2 Samuel, we need to do a little review, I guess. We need to remember that David has left the city of Jerusalem and is encamped in a place called Menahem right now, which is geographically, it's east of Jerusalem. It's across the River Jordan, where the River Jordan goes into the Dead Sea, and there's a lot of caves there. If you remember, David likes to hide in caves, and you can recall lots of interesting things happen in caves in Samuel. So they're there, and the reason that David and company are there is because they're on the run from David's son Absalom, because Absalom has done what? He's declared himself king, and he's occupying the palace in Jerusalem. Absalom takes the advice of the most trusted counselor in all of Israel, Ahithophel. He takes his advice when he tells him, "Go pitch a tent on the roof of the palace and sleep with your father's concubines that he's left behind, and that will make you a stench in the nose of your father. You'll burn all the bridges. There'll be no doubt that you're trying to seize the throne." But Absalom foolishly didn't follow Ahithophel's other piece of counsel, his other piece of advice, to say, Absalom said, "Let me gather together men and I will pursue David tonight. I'll pursue him right now because he's tired, he's exhausted, and he's disorganized. I'll go." And Absalom says, "Nah, let's listen to Hushai." Hushai says, "Gather a great army." And that's exactly what Absalom does. And remember, who is Hushai? He is David's friend. He is David's spy. And what happens? The delay allows David time to gather his troops. It allows David time to get rest. And that brings us to the 18th chapter, those opening four verses. David is mustering his troops. He's looking, gathering them together. He's looking at them in units of hundreds and units of thousands. And Joab and Abishai and Ittai the Gittite, they are made the generals, the battles. David is preparing to go into battle with them. And they say, no, don't go with us, because David, you are worth 10,000 of us. You need to stay behind here in the city in a supporting role. And I think that maybe David has reached the point in his life that his men are concerned for his safety in the battle. You know, he's lost a step. You know, his sword doesn't move as quickly as it used to. And David has enough sense about him to say, "Whatever seems best to you, I will do." And that brings us to verse 5. And we read there, "And the king ordered Joab and Abishai and Ittai, 'Deal gently for my sake with the young man Absalom.' And all the people heard when the king gave orders to all the commanders about Absalom." It was heard by everybody. Not just those three commanders, but all the people heard. Now, such a command would make sense if they were going into group therapy, wouldn't it? You know, but they're not going into group therapy with him. They're going into war. How do you deal gently with somebody in a battle? How can you do that? And it's strange that David doesn't refer to Absalom as his son in this verse. He refers to him as the young man. Deal gently with the young man, Absalom. And he's to deal gently with Absalom, not for Absalom's sake, but for my sake, David says. Do it for me. David is looking at himself. He sees the responsibility that he bears for Absalom's actions. The words of Nathan the prophet are probably echoing through his mind. The sword will not depart from your household because of this great sin that you committed with Bathsheba, and you've sent and had Uriah, her husband, murdered. David sees that his actions, that his choices, have had a direct impact on the lives of his children. You know, children grow up and they make their own choices and they do their own thing. But those choices are made in light of their parents and their parents' lives and the choices that we make. All that is sort of a preamble before the sermon. So here we go. Don't worry, we'll make it through. I have confidence in you, and you pray for me. We're going to look at the story through three main characters, through Absalom, Joab, and David. Absalom, Joab, and David. There are more people there, but we're going to look at those three main characters. Absalom is where we'll start. As we said earlier, the story is all about him, but he never says a word. He never takes any action in the story. Instead, he is acted upon. And the dies, it's just undignified, isn't it? Absalom's end is undignified. This poster boy, this handsome young man, the guy with the long flowing hair, I had no doubt that his poster probably adorned the wall of every teenage girl from Dan to Beersheba. You know, he was that good looking guy. He's on his mule, and his hair or his head, the Hebrew is kind of unclear, gets caught in a low lying branch of an oak tree. And the mule goes out from under him. And a mule was a king's mount. It was symbolic of the kingdom. So the mule goes out from under him. And symbolically, the kingdom leaves Absalom at that point when he's caught there hanging between, as it says in verse 9, between heaven and earth. He's alive. He's hanging there. And we don't know if he's conscious or unconscious, but he's there and he's alive. Then in verses 10 through 14, an unnamed soldier delivers the news to Joab. He says, "Joab, Absalom's hanging by his head or by his hair in an oak tree." And Absalom says, "Well, did you kill him? What do you mean you didn't kill him? This is the perfect opportunity. I would have promoted you and given you a huge cash reward." And the unnamed soldier knows how ruthless Joab is. And if you recall, you remember how ruthless he is, how Joab kills his enemies. And he heard the king's order, the unnamed soldier did. He heard the king's order to deal gently with Absalom. So this unnamed soldier is acting in obedience. He also knows this about Joab, that if he had killed him, Joab would say, hey, I didn't do it, he did. He would not stand by him. I think the scripture says he would stand, the man, unnamed soldier says, you would stand aloof with me, from me. Joab says, doesn't argue with him. And the reason I think he doesn't argue with him is he knows the guy is right. All Joab says is, I'm not going to waste any time on this. He brushes it off. And he promptly goes to the oak tree. He takes three javelins, sticks them in Joab's heart, in an Absalom's heart while he's still alive in the oak. Evidently, Absalom's not only a handsome guy, he's a pretty strong guy, because he's not dead yet, because the 10 armor bearers, the guy that's carrying all the Joab's armor around with him, they have to pounce on him and kill him. And that's the end of Absalom. Absalom was the darling of the media. He was, every time you open Facebook, there was Absalom. He was, somebody was tweeting about him. Somebody was on Instagram about him. He covered everywhere. And his death was like headline news. The death of an idol, like I think of Elvis. When Elvis died, it was everywhere. Or Michael Jackson. You couldn't turn on the TV. Or I guess more recently, it would be Prince. Somebody like that was all over the news. But you and I, the people who are reading this story, we know the secret, right? Remember last Sunday? I've got a secret. It's not registering. But you remember the secret here. If you don't remember, just look across the page to chapter 17, verse 14 in the second half. For the Lord had appointed to defeat the good counsel of Ahithophel to the intent that the Lord might bring evil upon Absalom. In other words, Absalom didn't stand a chance. Such is the case with everyone that sets themselves against God's anointed king and God's kingdom. This is a somber truth. But this truth, but God's people, we have no hope apart from this truth. No hope. There is no secure salvation for God's people unless God's judgment is brought upon God's enemies. Okay? We had better stop praying, deliver us from evil every Sunday, unless we truly long for desire the destruction of evil. If the kingdom of God is to be saved from the enemies that assault it, then those enemies have to be destroyed. Otherwise, you know, we're like a cancer patient who pleads with the surgeon, deal gently with the tumor, right? Please deal gently with the tumor. Just leave a little bit of the tumor behind. After all, it's a part of me. I've had it for such a long time, and I would hate to lose all of it. The preservation of God's kingdom involves the removal of God's enemies. As members of God's kingdom, as members of Christ's holy church, we dare not deal gently with those who would be enemies of the kingdom, with those who would compromise the truth of God's word. And at this point, you know, I had a very long, long list of the ways that the kingdom of God is being compromised and the way the church is compromising things. For example, the world tells us that all paths lead to God, but what does the scripture say? Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. The world says that our gender is just a construct that you choose for yourselves. The Bible clearly says that we are born male and female. And we could go on with the list, but I think you get the idea. We are to stand on the truth of the Word of God. And then along the same lines, as we think about dealing gently, we must not deal gently with sin in our own lives. Jesus tells us in Matthew 18, if your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off, throw it away. It's better for you to enter life crippled or lame than with two hands or two feet to be thrown into the eternal fire. If your eye causes you to sin, tear it out, throw it away. How are you dealing with your sin? Are you dealing gently with it? Jesus here is not telling you to literally cut off your hand or your foot or to rip out your eye. He's telling you that we must deal radically with the sin in our lives. We must do all in our power to pray and seek God and to remove all of the tumor of sin in our lives and then throw it away. Next is Joab. Joab is David's nephew. I believe Joab is David's sister's son. Then we'll jump down to chapter 19, 1 through 8 a little bit. We're going to be bouncing back and forth because Joab's all over it. But in there in chapter 19, there's a conversation, what we would refer to as a come to Jesus meeting, right? That's what Joab has with King David. The messengers come, they deliver the news to David and that Absalom is dead. And what does David do? He comes apart at the seams. He loses it, and we all understand that. It's the death of one of his children. But Joab knows that this is no time for blubbering and no time for crying. The people, at great cost, have won a victory for him. There'll be time to weep and time to mourn later, but not today. You know, Joab could have gotten his head chopped off for the things that he said to David. And if you read further into 2 Samuel, you'll see that Joab is demoted. And if you want to, you can go into, I think it's 1 Kings, the second chapter. You read where David tells Solomon, don't trust Joab, get rid of him. And indeed, Joab does lose his head there. I don't know if it's out of vengeance. I don't know what it is. I can't decide. But Joab is gone. The deed is done. In this story, Joab is a man's man. He's a military commander. He's the guy that all of the cable news networks want to interview about military strategy in Afghanistan. And what's going on here is there was, you know, everything that's going on at this point in the battle, it wasn't a time for him to consult the Geneva Convention. Somebody had to make a tough decision. And the tough decision was this. If Absalom lived, he would always be a thorn in the king's flesh. He would be a thorn in the side of the kingdom. If Absalom lived, every wannabe terrorist or wannabe king would rush to his side and it would never be over. So Joab, as a soldier and as a general, decides Absalom must die. And you read the account here, and there's no comment in the scripture about the morality of Joab's actions. You know, he moves against David's wishes. Joab decides that David's command is just flat out wrong. David might be the king, and he's under orders to carry out his wishes, but he makes a judgment call here. It's a judgment call that has to be made right then, at that moment in time. He couldn't take Absalom back to David because he knew if he took Absalom back to David, that would be it. Absalom would live. There was no doubt in his mind that David would spare him. So he takes matters into his own hands and he makes the decision. He's clearly insubordinate, but Joab does it for David's sake and for the sake of the kingdom. And as I read all of this, it reminded me of Colonel Jessup in the movie A Few Good Men. Anybody ever seen that movie, A Few Good Men? You remember the exchange between him and Tom Cruise toward the end of the movie, and Jack Nicholson, who's playing Colonel Jessup, says he's on the witness stand, and he says to him, "You want answers?" Cruise replies, "I want the truth." And everybody knows the next words, "You can't handle the truth," right? You can't handle the truth. We live in a world that has walls, and these walls are guarded by men with guns. I have a greater responsibility than you can even fathom. We use words like honor, code, duty. I have neither the time nor the inclination to explain myself to somebody who rises and sleeps under the blanket of protection that I provide. I just wish that you would say thank you and go on your way. That's sort of a rough estimation of that. You remember that? I think it was the best part of the movie. You know, that's Joab. That's Joab here in chapter 19. He's saying to David, your freedom, the freedom of this kingdom, is bought with a price. I have decisions to make, decisions that are life and death, and I have to make them. And you can sit there in your armchair and you can make your moral pontifications from far away from the battle, and you can print them in the newspaper or online, but I have to make a decision, and I have to make it right on the spot. Are you with Joab? You know, can we take a Cumberland Presbyterian straw poll, hands up for all that vote for Joab and understand what he did? I have a lot of sympathy for him. Militarily, politically, he's right. Absalom had to die. And you look at us this morning, you and I this morning, we sit here enjoying the freedoms and privileges of worship in public, and men and women have died so that we can have that freedom. And there are those right now who patrol the streets and the highways in our country to protect our laws and to protect our right to do all of these things. And we are to be thankful for them. And there are leaders, some of them who claim to be Christian, if you believe what they say and what you read in the newspaper, they are believers, and they're to have honor, loyalty, courage, duty, and resolve. These leaders have to make tough decisions and tough choices. Brothers, we need to pray for the, and sisters, we need to pray for the Joabs of our world. We need to have a burden to pray for them, because they have to make hard moral choices, moral decisions, decisions that they will be criticized for. In our current climate, that's what everybody wants to avoid. Oh, don't criticize me. I might be right, but I'll do anything as long as you don't criticize me. We have to pray for them that they would have the courage. Finally, there's David. He's received the news of the death of his son, and it's more than he can bear. And we can understand that. It's tragic. It's like, I think that a huge part of the tragedy for David is that he feels partly responsible. I think that he knew deep down that Absalom had no faith, that Absalom died outside of God's covenant, that Absalom died as an unbeliever, and that he would never see his son Absalom in glory. You know, I go back to when the child that was born of the adulterous union between he and Bathsheba, remember, that child died, and what did David say? He cannot come to me, but I will go to him. In other words, he says, I'm going to see that child in glory one day, but he can't say that about Absalom. I'm sure that David saw to it that Absalom went to temple, that he was taught the Bible, that he went to Sunday school, that he was in church. But as we have seen over the past few chapters of 2 Samuel, there was an obvious disconnect between David and his children in many ways. And if there's a disconnect in all of these other areas, I'm willing to say that there is a disconnect when it came to matters of faith. In other words, David took his children to church, but he didn't follow through on the taking them on what was necessary about taking them to church. In other words, there's more to it than that. I remember when I played basketball, you had to have the right follow through. If you don't follow through, you're going to more than likely miss your shot. The same's true with the pitcher in baseball. If they don't follow through, they're going to miss the target. You throw a pass in football, if they don't follow through, it's not going to go where you want it to go. If you want to hit your target, you have to follow through. Mom and dad, it takes more than bringing your kids to church to build their faith. It takes more than 2 hours a week. It takes more than Sunday morning and Wednesday night. Right now, we don't even have Wednesday night. We don't even have Sunday school on Sunday morning due to everything's going on. We have 1 hour. 1 hour. And you think 1 hour is going to overtake 167 other hours throughout the week unless we follow through? The studies are clear. In homes where the scriptures are read and prayers are had and shared together as a family at least 4 to 5 times during the week, those kids grow up to embrace the faith. Where that doesn't happen, there's a drift. The kids drift. Mom and dad, are you living out your faith in front of your children throughout the week? Can they see you reading your Bible for yourself? Can they see you praying for the things that you face in your life? Are you showing them that faith in Jesus Christ is real? are you following through? If you don't follow through, you'll miss the target. So David realizes that his son has died without the Lord, and it breaks his heart. Verse 33, "Oh, my son Absalom, my son Absalom, would I had died, would have I better look at that. Would I had died instead of you, O Absalom, my son, my son." There's not a parent here this morning, or a grandparent, I believe, that wouldn't lay down their lives for one of their children or grandchildren. Will you live your life for Christ in such a way that you might pass the baton of faith onto them, that they might gain eternal life? Will you follow through in that way? Will you teach them that the love of God and the worship of God ought to be and should be forever the very core of your life, the core of your very existence, the very heart of your home? Will you do that? Will you follow through? Final thought, I promise. When David cries out, "Would that I had died instead of you, O Absalom, my son, my son," I can't help but remember the fact that our Lord and Savior died instead of me. He died instead of you. That God the Father sent God the Son to die a horrible death upon the cross for our sins, the death that we deserve. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. As we remember the horrible price that was paid for our sins by God's one and only Son, may we grieve over our sins the way that David grieves over the death of his son. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your precious word. Lord, we've been looking at a story that took place some 3,000 years ago, but the truths that it communicates are abiding. Those truths are real here this morning. We pray for our leaders, for those who have to make tough decisions that they will be criticized for. Give them courage. Give them strength and conviction. We pray for our families this morning, for moms and for dads, for children and for grandchildren. May we live our lives in such a way as to help them see that faith in you and in your Son Jesus Christ is real, that it is abiding, that it is a faith that is with us throughout all of our days, 24/7, 365. And Father, make us ever mindful of the high price that was paid for our sin. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Our closing hymn is number 692, "God Will Take Care of You." And let's stand, please.
Lord, we thank you for your watchful care over us. May we be ever thankful for your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, give us courage and the strength of our convictions to live for you, to honor you, that we might pass the baton of faith on to others, that they might know the truth of the gospel that is your Son. In his name we pray. Amen.